not a YouTuber, just like making videos. This is a video I kind of want to do for a while, never got to it, is was Martin Luther King the enemy? Now, I know some people believe that, and Afrocentrics believe that he integrated us with the enemy and so forth. I'm like, what? We need to stop believing in the fairy tales. All right, first of all, we was already integrated with whites as soon as we got off that slave boat. You know, I'm like, we worked in his fields. We tucked his head in at night. We raised his children. I'm like, how much closer can we be? It was still, we were just more so under his thumb. You know what I'm saying? And we're still under the so-called white man's thumb. But people believe that before, you know, the civil rights era, which some people say it was just a consumer's rights, that blacks had their own businesses and the black family was all together. And I can understand what they're saying, you know, because if white people were denying us goods and services or wasn't treating us proper compared to the white customers, we'll take our money and invest into the black company, like the Negro League Baseball. The reason why we all should know, the reason why they integrated baseball is to get that black dollar. So I understand, you know what I'm saying, the argument that, you know, maybe they say that integrating with whites or civil rights was a waste of time, but I disagree with that. I think ultimately having civil rights is a good thing. It's good to have that on the side, because regardless of how black people are operating, you know, I'm like, it's not like we operated as a sovereign nation. We was already surrounded by a sea of white people, and they really kind of controlled a lot of our destinies. They controlled the judicial courts, the police officers. So even back when we was segregated and so forth, we were still going to the white men's jail cell. We were still standing in front of that white judge. You see what I'm saying? So, in the eyes of the court, is it good to have civil rights? You know, unless we've had our own police officers and own judges, but that wasn't going to happen unless we got sovereignty. You know, so whites were always in our beeswax. But, you know, going back into Martin Luther King, you know, integrating us with the enemy. Now, it should be common knowledge that Martin Luther King was assassinated by a 6 or 8 man sniper team. You know, James Earl Ray didn't do it. You know, I never believed he did do it. But, you know, they had a trial, another trial, and so forth. I'm like, this is not some kind of conspiracy you find in a book. I mean, this is real. And I think the assassination of Martin Luther King, which that summer was supposed to be the summer of prosperity, but it ended up being the summer of despair with all the riots that ricocheted through the so-called black community. And I think that done something to the psyche of black people. And, also with the shooting of Malcolm X, also it was almost like black people thought they were just trapped in an inferno of hopelessness and desperation and so forth. So I have to look at it as that aspect of blacks being broken, you know, and even after, you know, the civil rights law was passed. But if integrating with white people caused us to break our bonds, not invest in black communities anymore, for the black family to become dysfunctional, all right, we couldn't have been strong in the first place. Think about it. I'm like, as good as people say we was doing before the civil rights movement, a lot of black people were poor. We were sharecroppers. Matter of fact, one of the main reasons we were getting lynched was because, you know, of course, this was post-slavery. Blacks would be working in the field, sharecropping, so forth. But, you know what I'm saying, when it was time to settle up, the white man didn't want to pay them. Hence, a lot of blacks thought they went right back into slavery. So in retaliation, they'll burn down their barn or burn down their fields. So, the white dude will go out and find the perpetrator or who he thought was the perpetrator and lynch him for doing damage to his property. After we've gotten civil rights, I would say lynching did go down, if that means anything. But I just don't believe in any sort of hoopla or, you know, this Bolger Dash of MLK being the enemy, him being Bolé, and, you know, there's all kind of stuff going on about him. I'm like, you know, he had an affinity for light-skinned prostitutes. I'm like, you know, me personally, I said, I wouldn't care if he did. But as far as this, we were always integrated with white people, but at the same time we was always separated from white people. Think of New Orleans and places like Chicago. They suffer from hyper segregation. Matter of fact, I remember when I visited my girlfriend in Chicago, stayed there a weekend, you know, when I was dating this girl. I remember not seeing one white person, you know, other than I seen some Arabic Middle Eastern cab drivers and people who work the stores. I didn't see one white person. You know, only white people I saw was on TV. So, yeah. And, you know, that's kind of funny. But, as I said before, it's like, I don't think we'll ever reach, you know, racial equality in this country. I'm like, that's just a dream. And Martin Luther King, one of the reasons he was killed, because he was all about workers' rights, you know what I'm saying, helping out poor people, uniting the poor people. And hence, if they get over, poor white people, poor black people get over their difference and become some, and make some kind of alliance, and that will be, you know, power right there. And also his anti-war views, and, you know, and MLK had his radical side. Even Harry Belafonte, you know, a close friend of his, stated that Martin Luther King was worried that he was going to be integrating his people into a burning house and so forth. So that's interesting right there. But even before desegregation became the law of the land, there was always these pockets here in America that were trying to get rid of segregation. Like, for instance, I saw this documentary, and check out this documentary that took place in Clifton, Tennessee in 1957 about this school that was desegregating itself and all the racket that, you know, that went through that town of these black people and white people, black kids going to a white school. And this was 1957 in a town down south. So when it came to schools and the workplace, you know, there was always these, I'm like, it wasn't, not every aspect of American culture or these establishments were segregated. You know, it was just that Martin Luther King and so forth, just they, as I said before, they made it the law of the land. I'm like, hence, even still, the military, the U.S. military was integrated ever since the King Philip's War or some shit like that. It was integrated, and it was from like during the World War One, or not World War One, but the military didn't start segregating itself until like the War of 1812, if you know anything about that war. But during the war between the British, you know what I'm saying, the Revolutionary War, yeah, the military was integrated and so forth. That's a nice little piece of American history, but that's all I want to state. But I think that people are going to constantly throw mud on our leaders of past, just like they're trying to say Malcolm X was gay. I'm like, there's a there's actually a book written about Malcolm X having some sort of gay lover. You know, I kind of want to read that book out of curiosity, even though I know that book is just this. I'm like, it's probably complete Bolger Dash, too. So, thanks for watching.